There has been a lot of news this week, especially when it comes to graphics cards. More 4090 melting connectors, but we know what the culprit is. Info about the 7900 XT and an even more powerful big brother, leaked benchmarks of the 7700 non-X Ryzen CPU, and some Steam Deck news. We're going to talk about all that and more right here on Robeytech. Now, one of the biggest news stories to come out of the last few weeks has been this whole melting 4090 power connector in NVIDIA's new flagship GPUs. Now, we reported last week that it only had happened like a couple of times and was continuing to grow, at least a couple that had been reported. Well, it seems since then, things have gotten way worse, with more cards having literal meltdowns. And it seems that NVIDIA is working with AIB partners to come up with a solution. Rinaldo Busali from Tech Labs and Galaxy's OC team put on two live streams to demonstrate how they do stress and torture testing for the 16-pin power connector. Surprise, it can take a ton of power. Now, while they did do a few runs with different load variations, the important setup was 1530 sustained watts, which is way above what we actually get. In his testing, though, he discovered that improperly connecting the cable is what resulted in the extreme high temperatures and that it could be part of the root cause of people smoking their GPUs. While we were pretty much aware that bending the cable caused the pins to back out, now we know actually what's happening and how that's happening, and that the NVIDIA supplied adapter to the 4x8 pin cable is actually the culprit. Its inferior build quality has led to issues that looks to be the result of splitting the four 14 gauge wires onto six pins of the connector by soldering them onto bridges that aren't really strong enough to handle much stress at all from kinking or bending the cable. These solder joints end up breaking after they are bent and pins back out and result in the remaining connections heating up beyond their intended limits. In some cases, Galax found that a properly seated cable hits temps of 60 to 70 degrees Celsius, while a loose connection would hit temps upward of 100 degrees Celsius. That is a spicy meatball. Now, the good news is that NVIDIA is working with manufacturers and is having all the damaged carts sent to NVIDIA headquarters for analysis. Now, this is a first for them, so we'll wait to see what happens next. But for now, approved cables and cables from third-party manufacturers haven't had the same issues since they are built to a higher quality standard. Now, if you're looking for a particular cable, we have some that we've been using, and you can see them in our Call of Duty build and our 5800X3D showcase build. And we have links down in the description below if you actually want to pick one of these up. 16 gauge wires, no soldering, very, very good cables. Next up in our NVIDIA news roundup is the previously launched and unlaunched RTX 4080, the 10 gig, the 12 gig, the 35 gig, who cares? Point is, there are some retailers in the US and UK that have a mighty price point of $1,200 MSRP. At the moment, two online sellers have the 4080 listed. In the UK, it's Laptops Direct, and here it is in the US, it's Newegg. So far, the listings are pretty sparse, with Newegg only listing the PNY XLR8 Gaming Virto in overclock and non-overclock trim levels, though none of them are listed as in stock. In the UK, Laptop Direct has three pallet RTX 4080s listed. They have their Game Rock OC, Non-OC, and Omni Black cards listed for roughly £1,450 to £1,530. Now it's up to you. Are you thinking it's great to see the rest of the 4000 series lineup slowly starting to show up on store shelves and for sale? And don't worry, you can bet we are absolutely going to be bench testing them and building with them right here on the show. Now, last up in the Team Green Roundup, we're taking a look at the RTX 4090 running two games in some jaw-dropping configurations. First up, Golden Reviewer, who's a YouTuber, uploaded a video recently showing that they managed to get Genshin Impact running at 13K on their MSI RTX 4090 Gaming X Trio that was paired with an i7-10700KF. Kind of an interesting pairing there. Previously, they ran Genshin Impact at 7K with the highest quality setting and managed frame rates of over 100 frames per second. Then he ran it at 13760 by 5760, and it was absolutely insane how detailed everything was. In order to make this work, though, gameplay was limited to 30 frames per second on average. Wow, only 30 FPS at 13K. Your card is lame, NVIDIA. The screenshots the game takes resulted in an 80 megapixel image that was 80 86 megabytes and looked very detailed when you zoomed in. By the way, this was not done with DLSS or any AI upscaling, but who knows what could be possible in a game that supports DLSS. Can we get 26K? Come on, guys. Now, do keep in mind that when configuring your system to run on your GPU beyond its intended resolution, you can basically prompt you that any issues that happen as a result could potentially void your warranty. So, while this is a cool experiment, it's not the best idea until this is something that is officially supported. But I get it. Sometimes you need your Genshin Impact waifu to be as many pixels as possible. Am I right? Lastly, now we're no strangers to emulation on Robeytech, but we've talked about emulators to the Steam Deck, and getting Nintendo games to play on the PC is an everyday occurrence in the PC gaming world. But every now and then, you got something that takes emulation to another level. While it isn't Genshin Impact running at 13K, YouTuber Digital Dreams is running Simu. Now, if you don't know what Simu is the Nintendo Switch emulator. This individual managed to get Breath of the Wild, wait for it, running on an RTX 4090 paired with a Ryzen 9 7950X, so a beefy system. He got it to run in 8K with extreme settings using a ray tracing reshade preset that adds realistic ray tracing and improves global illumination. Wow, blah, 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 blah. All those words, hard to say, but it looks so good, all running at, what would you think? Can I hear a 60 FPS at 8K? While some intense time of day lighting scenarios are a bit extreme and end up looking like things were like glowing, when it's darker, wooded areas where like the light rays shine through, honestly, it takes your breath away. Wild. See what I did there? Now, okay, let's, Team Green, punt you. Okay, now let's take a look at what's going on with Team Red this week. This is a big week for Team Red. We've gotten a few leaks about the upcoming RX 7900 XT and the XTX RDNA3 GPUs. There's a Twitter user, ChiliDog, who has been pretty spot on with their leaks so far. And they have released two pictures that don't reveal a ton, but they look like they're part of the official AMD internal presentations. Now, sure, you could Photoshop, but let's just go with it. Now, these images show that the RX 7900 XT will ship with 20 gigabytes of RAM, and the 7900 XTX will release with 24 gigabytes of RAM, putting it squarely in the ring with the RTX 4090. Now, it also looks like we'll see the same standard output options with the two display ports, one HDMI port, and a single USB Type-C port, with a suspected 384-bit memory bus and a 20 gigabits per second clock speed. That is a massive, I do mean massive, step up from the previous generation flagship, the 6950 XT. Though, you know, we gotta admit that Halo one looked pretty freaking cool. And on top of that, by the way, it looks like AMD is taking advantage of that whole RTX 4090 nuclear meltdown situation, and a few individuals have confirmed through their AMD contacts that the new AMD cards will not be using that new 16-pin power adapter. Honestly, I don't know if this is as big of a deal anymore, because now we know that, as long as AMD isn't using NVIDIA power adapters, we're probably fine, because the 16-pin thing is actually okay, but whatever. The recent PCB leaks are showing that the AIBs are not only not using the 16-pin power cable, but instead are offering up to 3 8-pin cables to their 7000 series GPU designs. Now, reports are coming in that the power consumption will be higher than previous generations, surprise, but you know what, honestly, that's to be expected, but it's looking like it's still gonna be lower than the competition. So that 4090 will be like the beastly Dyson Sphere, and the 7900 XT and XTX are only gonna be like white dwarfs. By the way, the performance doesn't actually stop there, with reports of over 50% performance per watt increases over the previous generation. They also added like better ray tracing capabilities and AMD's new Infinity Cache, and it's looking like a powerhouse of a GPU lineup. Now, we'll likely see more about this on AMD's live stream on November 3rd, and when you're watching this, I will literally be on a plane on my way to Vegas to go watch this live, and you can absolutely tune in on November 3rd for our coverage, which will be breaking as soon as we can release it. But for now, let's just savor these rumors. It smells like tine and steak. Wait, what is this? Is that like a sea of thieves or like a ship filled with holes? Because it looks like we got another leak from AMD to talk about this week. Now, what we had mentioned in last week's episode, that AMD would be working on releasing a non-X version of the Ryzen 7700 CPU to give us like a more budget-friendly option in hopes of increasing the adoption rate of the new AM5 platform, we didn't know a whole lot more than it's coming and will perform slightly less than its X counterpart. Well, now we've got some numbers to go with. Now, leaks from Geekbench 5 database are showing that the 7700 non-X version, running up to 5.3 gigahertz and using only 65 watts of power. Now, the non-X CPU has 8 beefy cores and 16 threads with a base clock of 3.8 gigahertz, which is 700 megahertz slower than the X version. But seeing that the boost clock for this budget CPU is only 100 megahertz slower than its big brother is actually amazing. Now, while we haven't officially seen what it's supposed to run at, this one managed to get 5.3 gigahertz to be precise. Okay, so this sets it like in a whole interesting position regarding AMD's new lineup. See, the 7700 is positioned just under the 7600X, which makes sense in terms of performance, with the 7600X having the same boost clock, but a higher base clock than the 7700, but using more power and possibly having a higher price point. Now, since we don't know exactly how much it's cost, we can't really figure out how it really ranks in the new lineup. But if it's cheap enough, then the price of performance could be amazing when it's running its boost clock speeds. And our last set of news from last week, which you could check out right here, we talked about the Steam Deck. And we always like to put a little Steam Deck news in every episode. Now, a while ago, we reported that the JSAO, with their amazing Steam Dock Deck that they were making and let you expand storage of the Steam Deck with a built-in NVMe storage slot. Well, it looks like they were planning to make a gamer version of this that had RGB LED ring that went around the base, which, I mean, not only, why is it gamer? Because RGB equals more frames, duh. And to be honest, it would have been awesome. I say that it would have been because it turns out that JSAO found out that their manufacturer leaked or copied their development scheme. Now, we don't know who has stolen the design or who shared it specifically, but JSAO was informed by a Steam Deck media editor that another brand had released the RGB product and it was completely the same as theirs. In their post, they shared a screenshot of a tweet with a blanked out username from October 9th that said that their new Steam Deck dock with flash lights would be coming soon. The tweet was promptly deleted after they were discovered by JSAO. But this is where it starts to get crazy. JSAO doesn't just stop there, like once they finally discover this and then they take it down. JSAO then goes on to share their design renderings and projects with dates they had started, screenshots and all, and stated that they had already applied for a patent as well. They had sent out some devices to Steam Deck media and influencers, unfortunately not me, for testing and feedback, but after the leak and the fact that the company rebranded the device with their own logos, JSAO has made the unfortunate decision to pull the plug on the project and abandon their mold after severing ties with the manufacturer. Surprise, surprise. Now, while this sucks, it is something they had to do to protect themselves in the long run since their competitor got their product out before they could. Now, if they had stayed the course, then there is a high chance that it would have ended up in like a costly legal battle that they honestly probably just didn't want to deal with. Instead, you know what they're going to do? They're going to go back to the drawing board. They're going to pull themselves up by their bootstraps and design a new look with a different RGB lighting effect. And this means there will be a few months of delay before they can get like another product out. And hopefully somebody doesn't share that too. But this acts as a word of caution too. If you happen to see one of these things on sale, know that it's actually their design and it wasn't manufactured by the individual selling it. So don't buy it. Don't be a jerk. Pro JSAO, I guess. I don't know where to go with that. Back when we started talking about our first Steam Deck news, which you can watch right here, Valve had actually announced that people love the Steam Deck UI, and I'm one of them, so much that they would be bringing it to like the big picture mode on PC. Well, ladies and gentlemen, the wait is over because the big picture overhaul is available for testing right now. Now, it's been a while since Big Picture Mode received any huge update with like minor changes and improvements over time. This is a welcome change since it still looks largely the same as it did when it launched, and it's still the only way to configure controllers for Steam, so you have to use their like mode with a UI that's like a decade old at this point. So we'll get to see a new home screen, better search functions, the improved controller configurator, better navigation to the store with a controller, system menus, and in-game overlay, and more. If you have the Steam client beta, you can check it out, but you'll need to create a shortcut and add a dash gamepad UI to the target field, but most people will want to wait for it to officially release. To be honest, guys, I don't know, man. It's just gonna be buggy until then. Well, that's it for news this week. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Are you weary of the 4090 and its nuclear meltdown, even though you know what the culprit is? Are you excited about the new flagship AMD GPUs like we are? What do you think about the like Steam Deck UI coming to Big Picture Mode, and do you even use Big Picture Mode currently? And lastly, are you gonna run Genshin Impact at 13K? I'd love to know all that and more down in the comments below. Now, while you're down there, go ahead and tap that like button and subscribe button right there, and go ahead and turn on notifications so you don't miss another video that's awesome like this one. Now, be sure to check out our live streams right here on YouTube or over at twitch.tv/Robeytech, which you can basically watch on either Monday, Thursdays, or Saturdays starting at 5 p.m. Pacific time. And before you go, why not head over to your favorite social media platform and give us a follow? We're on Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, and Discord. Sorry guys, we just cut Tinder. So drop us a follow and head on over to discord.gg/Robeytech to continue the conversation with other people who would love to talk to you about these super awesome, either sweet PC and gaming goodness that we have going on. Anyway, that is it for us. Thank you so much for watching, and we will see you on the next one.